Eric Carlson, he loved food, always a good meal. And he could really enjoy and appreciate a 9-dish meal in France with 3 stars in the Michelin Guide and a fantastic wine. But most of all, he enjoyed a sausage sometime. I remember a day when he came to the museum in the morning and he said, "I was in Oslo yesterday evening." "Why?" I said. "You know, there is a sausage joint in the Karl Johan area. It's beautiful. It's so nice sausages." "You mean you went to Oslo and back again for a sausage?" "No, I bought 3, of course." So therefore now, at the Saab original tent, for you, 1,500 sausages with hot sweet mustard, the Eric Carlson way. And someone that has been eating a lot of hot dogs together with him is his co-driver from the 283, Gunnar Palm. Welcome up on the stage. I think we have about 10 seized pistons here in the Saabs at the moment, Gunnar.
Yes, I was afraid it would go even quicker. But it's very enjoyable to be here with you and all these fantastic old Saab fans.
It is an honor for us to have you here. And a Saab festival without Eric Carlson is not a Saab festival. I think that's true, but he's here in another way. And it's very suitable that we have so many Saab enthusiasts here honoring him. And I think he definitely likes what he sees at the moment.
I could hardly believe that there are so many still remembering Eric. And when I got the message a week and a half ago that he was gone, I was very glad that we had spent these years together and all this enjoyment he has brought to me. And it has taken this a week and a half to memorize all the happy moments. But it's when I arrive here and I see and I feel all the enthusiasm and you bring, and Peter, thank you for organizing this fantastic gathering to honor Eric. I'm touched, and I'm really touched to see also the written words about Eric, because for the youngsters, you can never believe what he has done for Saab and for Trollhättan and for the rally sport itself. He was the number one rally driver in the world when hardly people didn't know what rally was about. And I'm so glad that I could enjoy 2-3 years with him sitting, especially in the Monte Carlo, but also in this Lier, Sofia Lier, where we managed to be second, which Torbjörn Trollby has described. And the way Eric could drive so many hours without being tired, it was unbelievable. Lier, Sofia Lier was 96 hours, and we had the smallest car with the smallest engine, and still we managed to be second. That was an achievement. No one can ever believe what he did there.
Rallying today, Gunnar, is, as Eric said, office rallying. You start at 8 o'clock in the morning and you start at 5 p.m. and then you are at the dinner table at 6 o'clock. But at that time, you didn't have any breaks whatsoever. You were more or less driving for 96 hours on incredibly rough roads.
But we had 1 hour stop.
1 hour stop.
In Sofia, in Bulgaria, where the rally ended the first etape. Then we went backwards towards Lierse in Belgium. And on the way back, we passed the Dolomite Alps in Italy. And if you pass ever Passo di Gavia or Passo di Vivione, which is gravel roads with steeps about 1,000 meters deep, then you can keep your laugh. because that's what we had to do the last night. And incredible to be able to drive on these conditions when you had done so many hours already in the car. So please take a look when you go to Italy. Passo di Gavia, Passo di Vivione, and you have seen the worst or the most dreadful route you can ever think of.
And how do you manage to stay awake during so long and driving fast and competitive? Coffee or?
I think first of all, I fall asleep now about after 9 o'clock, I'm dead. But it was enough to sleep with 10, 15 minutes and you sort of recovered. But how Eric could stand, because he drove, as I remember it, all the way himself. Maybe I took a wheel for a while. And there we made a system where we changed at the driving seat while we were still driving. Eric leant forward, put his still the accelerator on. I climbed from behind and slid down. And there we changed drivers while the car was on the move. So we didn't lose many, many seconds while the car was a little bit slower.
It's incredible, really. And something that I feel when I was working with him the last 20 years, even as he's older, he was always very competitive. And he always delivered 101% when it matters. And I think he was one of the first drivers to use what we call today mental physiological theories, you know, about bringing pictures about him standing on the winner's podium and always going for the first position. And today, new stars in athletics, they learn this in school bench, so to say. But he used these principles from the beginning without knowing that he was a trendsetter in it.
I don't think he had any pictures more than he wanted to win, and he was bloody stubborn all the time. I mean, there was, I think you are stubborn a lot in Trolletta, but he was worse. He could be go through walls if it was necessary to win. And he was also, and this must be said, that he was a good team builder. He didn't do much work himself, but he looked after others to do the job. So he was sure that the job was done properly. And he was a tough director in the car, I tell you. There was no messing around. And if you happen to misshoot, to overshoot the junction, then the world came. Meaning he had seen too much of the world if he had to reverse for 50 meters.
Yeah. And after his career, he had a magnificent career, it was a driving career, as a PR personality, and worked for Saab Communications to the end of Saab Automobile, effectively, traveling on more or less every Saab PR thing around the world and also on the car exhibitions. And to have Eric Carlsson at the Saab exhibition area was a guarantee to getting the biggest journalist there, because I know something interesting will happen.
With the way he spoke English, I mean, it was Swenglish, it was Trollhätte English. I think he didn't miss a beat. I'm sure he got his word to the people he talked to. And there is many stories how he came along with his sort of Swenglish language, but he was also a PR man. I don't think he ever knew what PR stands for. I think he thought it meant in Swedish på restaurang. but he was a communicator without even, I think, able to write a single page, to be frank. I mean, writing and so that was not his cup of tea.
I think he was even worse in administration than me. But he all the receipts he had from traveling, he didn't leave them in a bag. It was in an envelope, and it was in chronological order. And then some, we say, very, very nice colleagues within the PR department sorted them out. But his memory for names and faces is unbelievable.
Yeah, true. And there is also a good sob story I remember right now, and that was, he got complained from the boss of Saab, I think his name was Svante Holm at the time, and he was complaining that there was too heavy bills on petrol, that he had used too much petrol when he was on a rally and doing the practice. So Erik went up with his envelope with all these receipts, all these kvitto, and threw it on the table and said, "You better drive if you don't think it uses petrol."
And you have been on a lot of adventures. You came second once in the Safari Rally. You have seen we have done something into the museum shop with an odd coffee. And I would like to hear the true story, because Erik did never lie, but he was a pretty good storyteller, so to say. So can we hear the true story about how you rolled the Saab 96 Sport in the Safari Rally 64? Facts, please.
Yeah, now you should hear the complete story then, if we have time. Anyway, it was in 1964. We drove in what they call near Dar es Salaam in Tanzania, Tanganyika at that time. And we were climbing up a small slope where there was a river down there. And the rain had washed away all the good road. So he had to take off the road and go on the bank. And suddenly we were stuck in mud even there. So there was nothing more to do than out I jumped, and he didn't really like to go out when it was muddy, because I said, "You better go out because my shoes are too new." I got hold of a couple of local guys, and we rolled the car. I said, "Now you stay in the car, and we roll it over and over and out on the proper road again." And there we were in the middle of the night in Africa. We rolled the car over and over, and we crashed the windscreen on a stone or whatever it was. And then he has started up, and off we went again. And we came to Nairobi, we were second, and nobody believed that we had done what we actually had done. They said, "You have been on the roof again, Mr. Carlson. You have been driving too far." Erik was a bit förbannad. So he said, "Now we should show them at the prize giving." So we took the car and rolled it over and over again on the grass outside the city hall in Nairobi. And there, that's why we have the coffee now from Kenya inside here, where you can buy with the car number 28. But we still made it second. And that was the best result a foreigner had had so far.
And there is... And the second thing is, on the newspapers covering the Safari Rally 1964, on the front page, it wasn't the winning Ford Cortina. It was the white Saab up and down. And that annoyed your former colleagues at Ford, Gunnar Palm.
Yes, there was a fantastic prize giving and a dinner, a dance or whatever you call it, a ball in the city hall afterwards where there were thousands of people. The winning Cortina was there, and all the British mechanics were a bit high, to say the least. And when the newspaper came out during this dinner, the Daily Nation, there was the Saab on the front page. Of course, they were a bit upset, the English, that we had won the sort of PR battle. We got the news in the papers. So the mechanics there took the cortina, rolled it the same way we had done. Except that next morning, Ford had to pay a new parquet floor on the city hall in Nairobi. There were batteries, there was oil, there was petrol and mud all over the floor. So there was a new floor to be paid by Ford.
And according to the rumors, restoring the oak floor in the city Nairobi city house costed Henry Taylor more than participating with five cars in Safari Rally, all included. And it's a lot of stories about Eric and his personality. He teach me a lot of things. This was in 1997 when it was the 50th anniversary for Saab in USA. And we were going to a restaurant, believe it or not. We were informed by the PR director at Saab at that time, Elke Martin, behave yourself when you go on the road with a car. Because there is a lot of policemen here now, and you have a tendency of speeding, Eric. Oh no, we will take it quite and easy, I promise. So we went away in the Saab convertible, and it was of course pretty fast. And I said to Eric, behave yourself, it's, you know the policemen, they come from nowhere in this country. And they did. And I was sinking down in the co-driver's seat, and Eric said to me, listen and learn, boy, this might be useful later in your life. And he stopped the car, the policeman was coming out and unhooking the gun, and I was sitting there. And he put down the window, took up both hands and said to the police, look there, no gun, no gun. And the policeman was coming and then he said, hello there, old chap, how are you doing? And the policeman didn't really run the conversation, I can tell you. No speeding tickets, valuable lesson for me. But of course you have to combine it with the charisma. And Eric Carlson is absolutely incredible in that case. Also traveling with him on an airport. You're sitting there waiting for something to happen. You see a lot of people. You think about, that person looks a bit strange. Wonder where he comes from. And of course, Eric thinks the same thing. But he connects the mouths immediately and says, hello there, you look a bit strange. Where do you come from? If I'm in doing that, I will be smacked. And the person says, well, I come from Africa. It's that tribe, it's quite colorful. Where do you come from, by the way? From a place you never heard of, Tralata. And we have so many stories. And the good thing with Eric is we can continue to talk about them. Not really the way he can do it, because he was absolutely unique. And I said to a lot of people, if he is going to have a seminar or speech, go and listen to him. Oh, no, 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 I'm not the car guy like you. That's not the thing with Eric, because when he talked, he didn't really talk so much about the Red Saab standing here. He talked about people that happened to cross his way and the very, very interesting situations that occurred. Because going in rallying, like you did in that time together with Eric, was of course meeting a lot of people. Do you have any more, I would say, unrevealed story about Eric and that you can reveal before we going into the sausages, Gunnar?
No, I think they are not worth telling here, or they are too much worth telling. So I think I rather keep this for myself.
Probably very wise. An applause, Gunnar Palm. Thank you for coming for Trollhättan and honoring Eric. And now a short break. Go, turn around, go to the tent, go for the sausages before I grab them, because I'm hungry. And we will continue with some interviews here on stage. Thank you so much.
Sen är frågan om...
Jag kanske delar.
Jag tänkte på det. Det kanske är bättre.